for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for us. So if you're happy and you know it, say amen.
Amen.
And if you don't mind, give God a hand praise. Again, for his goodness, his greatness, and his just unique kindness toward us. We know that we are currently in our world actually dealing with a different kind of atmosphere, a different time, a different season. In some cases, it's something that our generation has not experienced. Of course, we do know that these kinds of things have happened, transpired in the world at some point in history, whether it was with the smallpox or the bubonic plague or whatever it was, that at some point in history, these experiences did happen. It's just that something is unique to our particular lifetime. And so in the midst of it all, well, we know that God is still gracious.
Yeah, yeah.
God is still good. God is ultimately still in control. And I believe that this is the time that we who are the people of faith need to express that. We need to worship him and praise him in the midst of it all, just again to let him know how much we appreciate who he is and all that that he does. Our children are going to be leading us, I believe. It's okay. We're gonna have it covered then. We're gonna have it covered. So we're gonna open up right now with a song, and Warren's gonna lead us in song. If we would just all stand together as we go worship God, let's do that even now. Thank you.
Every praise. Let's put our hands together and sing every praise to our God.
Glory, hallelujah, it's who I got.
worship. God, our Savior, God, our healer, God, our deliverer. Would you just put that up on the screen? I'm going to read Psalm 46, just as a reminder to us again of God's greatness. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. So what do I do as a result? He says it in verse 2, therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with swelling. There is a river whose stream shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her just at the break of dawn. The nations rage and the kingdoms remove. He uttered his voice and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. And that's my encouragement to us, to know the Lord of hosts, the Lord of many, the Lord of the whole world, the Lord of the multitude, the Lord of everybody is with us. Not only is he with us collectively, but he is with us personally. He is with us privately. He is with us secretly. The Lord of hosts, he is with us. And so we're reminded, we just sung that song, and we ought to be reminded of that in our heart. God is my Savior. God is our healer. And if we go through anything, God is the one that can deliver us. And notice what we say, yes, he is. Yes, he is. Listen, I don't in any way take what's going on lightly. I don't think any of us should, not in it for any moment, for any minute. But at the same time, we gotta trust that God. Because we say it all the time. Either we believe it or we don't believe it. We gotta believe that our God is in control of all of this. He's aware of what's going on, and he knows how to handle his world because it belongs to him. Can you imagine taking care of 7 billion folk at the same time? Man, sometimes we got trouble just taking care of one person, that's us. But he takes care of 7 billion people at the same time and never get what anybody needs mixed up with what anybody else needs. He knows what he is doing. And we take great comfort in that. So let's go to God and pray. Father, how we love you. How we thank you again for being the awesome God that you are, for being the benevolent God that you are, the caring God that you are, dependable, excellent, faithful, gracious, holy, all of those things, that's who you are. And we're grateful, Father, that we're able to come from the south, from the north, from the east, from the west, that we've gathered together in this place to give you the worship, honor, and glory that you so rightfully deserve. God, we know again that you are worthy of praise. We know you're worthy of the glory because it's you that took care of us while we slept on last night. Somebody say, well, Lee, I had insomnia. I didn't sleep but 10 minutes. But Lord, if it was 10 minutes, it was you that took care of us for those 10 minutes that we were not even aware of what was going on around us. And so, Lord, in spite of what's going on in our world, we're here to say thank you. We're here to give you the praise. We're here to give you the glory. We're here to shout to your name. We're here to magnify you. We're here to let you know we are so appreciative for who you are. We are so appreciative for the things that you have done. So right here, right now, Lord, we will not hold back anything. We will not cross our arms and act like you don't deserve the praise. We will not pretend as though that there's a dark cloud that's hanging over us, because we know you know how to cause the sun to shine on the just as well as the unjust. You cause it to rain on the just as well as the unjust. So, Lord, we are here to say thank you for being who you are. In spite of pain, we give you praise. In spite of the fact that things are not as we would desire them to be, we thank you for things as well as they are. Because we know today that you still got all power. We know you still know everything. We know you're still everywhere at the same time. So I pray, God, that you would help each and every one of us who have gathered in this place today, not only us, Lord, but churches all over the world that have gathered together in your name. Some have gathered by live streaming, some are gathering together in person, but Lord, whatever way they gather again, we hope that you get the glory, you get the honor, and you get the praise, because there is no one like you, no one deserving as you're deserving, because you are our God, you are our healer, you are our deliverer. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. So give us all that mindset, not to hold anything back for today. Wait for tomorrow, because we don't know if tomorrow is promised to any of us. Help us to give you what you deserve even now. We ask, Lord, that you would accept our service of worship and our songs and our prayers, the reading of your word, the instruments that will be played today, the songs that will be rendered, the preached word that will go forth, every prayer that will be prayed. We pray you accept our service of worship, every gift that we give. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you receive our children now as they lead us in song? And let's not act like we at BET. We're not here to be entertained. We're here to give God the praise. Amen. Amen.
All right. Let's get a little hand clap and praise one more time. We can put our hands together, even though we're not touching each other. We can put our hands together. We know we've been declared a pandemic in this nation, but you know what? The songs say, I'm going to wait on the Lord. We can all sing that, uh-huh. This is for the saint, a message for the saint. This is for the saint, this is for you all, this is for the saint. A little bit louder now.
I'm gonna wait.
Yes, I am.
I'm gonna wait. Mercy.
For our youth, our young adults, our children. Give God a hand praise for our musicians. Amen. Thank you so much, brothers and sisters, for your contribution to this service thus far in this day. Shall we bow just right where we are? Let's go to God in prayer just right where we are. Amen. 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 Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done. Earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory, is all forever. Father, here we come once again, as we have come so many times, recognizing again you as our Father, the one who cares for us, the one who knows us better than we know ourselves, the one who, as the saints would say, touched us with the finger of love this morning, and our eyes awakened to a brand new day. Day we've never seen before. And when this day is gone, it'll be a day we've never seen exactly the same way again. And so God, we thank you for the variety of your blessings, your variety of your grace that you bestow upon us in terms of what we see, what we hear, what we taste, what we touch, what we smell. Father, thank you for experiencing your glory on that level. And then we thank you, God, for the joy, the love, the peace, the kindness, the faithfulness, the long-suffering, the self-control. Thank you, God, for the spiritual blessings that you have given us in your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, in whom we have every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. And so, God, as we're here this morning, we come again, as you've already seen us, you already have examined our hearts, whether or not we clap, whether or not we praise, whether or not we worship. And here we come again, Lord. If in any way, even in this day, that we fail to do those things that have been pleasing to you, we ask, Lord, that you would forgive us of our sins. We confess it before you and recognize that we count on your forgiveness, because you are faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of our unrighteousness. And so, God, this moment that we come is always for the purpose of intercession. And so we want to intercede today on behalf of Sister Betty Savannah. You know Betty's situation better than we do. You know her body better than we do. And then we pray, God, that as a result of where she is in the nursing home, we know things are on lockdown right now. Greta, daughters, the brother Mose, others can't really see about her as they would desire. So, Lord, we pray, as you reminded us this morning, that you are God, you are the healer, you are the deliverer. Yes, you are, yes, you are, yes, you are. And we pray that same for Sister Carolyn Bidd. God, we thank you. Horace can still look on her through his camera, but it's not like being with his wife. But God, we do know that in spite of the fact that her husband can't be there, we know that you are there. And we thank you for knowing that Carol and Betty Savannah are doing well in your hands. And God, we ask again your grace and your mercy continue to be upon them. For Aunt Drill, who is yet in the hospital and be there for another couple of days. God, we ask again your grace and your mercy be upon her to allow the medications to work the way they need to work so that she can recover from the issues that she is dealing with. Father, we know again that you are powerful. We know you're great and that you are good. Lord, the prevalence again of the coronavirus all over the world. We pray, Lord, not only for those that have been infected, but we pray for those that are being affected as a result of what is happening in our world. God, what we do know is you could have stopped it. Oh, yeah, we know you got that kind of control. We know you could have kept it from happening had you chose, but God, in your own way, and for those of us who love you, we see that you letting us know you running this thing. For those of us who know you, for those of us who depend on you, you letting us know this is still your word. And anytime you want to do whatever you want to do, whatever you choose to allow in your world, we know you have the power. God, we don't charge you. As the word already reminds us, we're not charging you at all with evil because we know you can't do evil. But we know that there's evil in our world and everything is under your control. Everything is under your dominion. Everything is under your power. So God, for whatever reason, whether we find out right now, whether we find out in the by, for whatever reason it's happening all over the world, we pray your will be done. We pray your kingdom come. And then God, we pray that you would help us in this time of trial to apply your word. You said to be anxious for nothing, but in everything through prayer and supplication to let our requests be made known unto you, and you promised that the peace of God would surpass all understanding. Will guard our hearts and our minds through Christ Jesus. So Lord, for every member of our congregation, from Sister Field to the babies that are yet in the mama's bellies, we ask again your grace and your mercy be upon us. Help us in every way to trust you. Help us in every way to depend on you. Help us in every way to rely on you, that we know that you are in heaven and you do just as you please. That whatever you do is always the right thing. Whatever you do is always the wise thing. Whatever you do, it cannot be done any better than what you do it. And so we thank you for being that kind of God. We pray now that you will be with us as we speak through your word. Say with us what you want to say. Do with us what you want to do. And we're going to be careful to give you the honor, the glory, and the praise that is yours and yours alone. It is Christ's name we pray, and we pray it for his sake. Amen. Amen. If God has been good to you, say amen. If you don't mind giving him a praise, just do that right on. Because he is that kind of God. It's good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. I guess these are the weeks that prove to us we ain't got to be here. We don't have to be here. So it's greater evidence to us that all of us are making it what? By the grace of God. I think somebody used to say that, to sing a song, by the grace of God, I come a long way. And that is the reality for each and every one of us. So it's good to see all of you here on today. We are asking that you pray for Brother Warren Johnson. Warren is in process. There's a new endeavor that the Lord has allowed him, that he's not only our musician here at the Good Shepherd Church, but he's also starting today going to be ministry, or part of the music ministry of the New Guide Church under Pastor Hubbard, and he's starting that endeavor today at 11 o'clock, and we just pray God's strength. Yeah, we pray God's strength for him as he moves forward in expanding the ministry and the gift that God has given him. Warren, again, we just pray that God allows you to do what you love to do, and that is to bring glory to him, and so we are grateful and thankful for him having that opportunity serve in that capacity. Matthew chapter 6. I'm trying to finish. Matthew chapter 6, if you would stand just for the reading of the word of God. Matthew chapter 6. Amen. And we are looking at verse 12 Smith says, and notice there is a successive conjunction from the previous verse. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts. Yeah. As we forgive our debtors. Do not lead us to temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. And again, as we have always said, our Father, please forgive us. Please forgive us. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I need to check right now just to see how many of you all did the assignment of last week and read Daniel chapter 9. Oh, thank you, Carol. Thank you, Sienna. For anybody else that's read, amen. Thank you so much, dear. Thank you so much. Yeah, I know y'all just forgot. I know. Y'all had a lot on y'all mind this week, and I absolutely understand. But I wanted to help us to see something in Daniel chapter 9 as it relates to this passage that we are looking at, is that it helps us to understand the language of the believer. It helps us to understand the language of a follower of Jesus Christ. It reminds us that our language is not a language of me and my. Our language is a language of we and us, or we and our. It is the language that God has given to us. When we look at Daniel chapter 9, just paraphrasing again, those of you who didn't get a chance to read it, it is at a point in Daniel's history, it's a long history, that Daniel literally lived under four different kingdoms during his ministry. He started in Babylon as a 16-year-old, after Babylon was defeated by the Persians, and then that with the Medes, and then ultimately Daniel was a governor. He was a ruler in high authority, and literally even at the point of the end of his ministry, when Daniel is reflecting on the fact that the children of Israel are in the condition that they're in because of their disobedience to God. They are scattered all over the world. Some are in Babylon. Others are in the area of Samaria because of what has happened when the Assyrians overtook them. So they're scattered all over the world. He prays to God, but when he prayed, he admitted and included himself in the prayer. To the extent that when we look at Daniel's life, that there is no record in terms of him committing a sin, of him doing something against the will of God, but his prayer was a communal prayer. It was a prayer that was inclusive. Daniel did not exclude himself to the point that it gave the sense, Oren, good to see you, it gave the sense that he was, if you would, exempt from sin, that he was exempt from disobedience to God, because what he understood, that what happens to one of us literally happens to all of us. And so he is praying. He prays again for the nation, and he uses the language over and over throughout that passage. You see him say, we have sinned. We have rebelled. We have disobeyed your command. He says it over and over and over and over again, reminding you and I that sin is such an issue that we still got to deal with, that regardless to how strong we are in the Lord, every day we need God to forgive us for something. And so Daniel uses that communal language, and he reminds you and I of the importance of asking God to forgive us for what we need. Therefore, when we come to Matthew chapter 6 and we see the second part of verse number 12, where it says, and forgive us our debts, notice the clause, as we forgive our debtors. It is not an issue of us recognizing that we're just asking God to forgive us for the things that we have done. We are also asking God to forgive us to the extent that we have forgiven others. That's what we're saying to God. And so Jesus, in teaching us these principles about the kingdom, the very kingdom that Daniel prophesied, the very kingdom that Daniel was talking about, even in Daniel chapter 9, chapter 7, chapter 8, chapter 9, even in the chapter 12, those things that he talked about as it related to the kingdom, he wanted it to be understood clearly that this kingdom that we're talking about now has literally come, but that kingdom has come in the person of Jesus Christ. And Jesus says to us, when you pray, these are the things that you ought to do. Is there anybody that needed forgiveness for anything this week at all? Anybody? I hope I'm not the one. I don't think I'm the only one. Anybody at all? We recognize that there are things that we can do that are contrary to the word of God. So he reminds us again in the word that as we forgive our debtors, as we forgive our debtors, the thing that he wants us to understand is that, you may have to help me with this. Thank you. We, according to scripture, also request release, pardon, or dismissal for all of the people just as we are released by our Father. Remember that word forgiveness means I need pardon, I need forgiveness, I need dismissal, I need to be released from a debt that is owed. In other words, what we keep in mind that anytime we rebel against God, this word in this particular prayer is reminding us that it is as a debt that we owe to God. And it is a debt that has to be paid back. But the only way that we can pay it, we have to ask God, because remember, there's nothing. You ask the question, what shall I render unto the Lord? What can I give the Lord? The only thing that I can give him is the things that he requests of me. And what he says to me is that, Lee, I want you to ask me for forgiveness. Regardless of what you've done, ask me for forgiveness. But Lord, I'm not only praying that you forgive me, but I'm asking you to help me forgive others just as you have forgiven me. Notice again the verse. Go back to it. And forgive us our debts, how? As we. There isn't the grammar that is that's a thing that's called the dative case, and it actually has to, or the accusative case. It actually has to deal with the fact that it deals with the extent. It has to deal with how far it goes. So in other words, what I'm saying to God, I want you to forgive me as far as I forgive Timothy Johnson. Lord, forgive me as far as I forgive Patsy Gatterson. Lord, forgive me as far as I forgive Jordan Harris. Lord, forgive me as far as I forgive Richard Davis. So if I want to experience God's total forgiveness, I've got to be willing to totally forgive. If I want to experience the freshness that comes from forgiveness, I have to be willing to give that freshness of forgiveness to others that have done things against me. You remember, I think on last week, a couple of weeks, I've been telling you, when we think about all the things that we can do against God compared to the few things that folk can do against us, it really doesn't compare at all. It is almost as far as the east is from the west in terms of what we can do against God in our mind, in our thoughts, in our words. Those things that we can do in our actions is far beyond whatever a person may do toward me. Now watch this. I am not suggesting that what people do don't hurt. Oh yeah, it hurts. But understand that the things that we do also hurt God. But I know what y'all say, I don't hurt God. Well, listen to what the Bible says. In Ephesians chapter 4, he says, don't grieve the Holy Spirit. That word grieve there means to make one feel sorry. It is the sorrow that one can experience at the loss of a loved one. If you've ever had somebody to die, you understand the intensity of that pain. And so anytime we act independent of God, God, and we choose to do what we want to do. The Holy Spirit who lives in us is sad. He is literally grieved. He is literally sorrowful in us because we've disobeyed the command of God. So yes, that's as well as people can hurt us, we can very well say, paraphrasing, that we hurt God because we grieve his Holy Spirit. So he reminds us again. He reminds us again, as we forgive our debtors, we also request release, pardon, or dismissal for all of the people just as we are released by our Father. So it's worth repeating again. If you want God to forgive you, you got to be willing to forgive others. As a matter of fact, he reminds us that. Look at verse 14. For if you forgive men, that's a generic term there. In some cases, we can talk about forgiving us who are brothers and sisters in Christ. But the Lord says now, if you forgive men, that means anybody that will hurt you. Now, you know, one of the things that I've learned, what we've got to come to recognize is that some things that we call an offense are really not an offense. It's really a personal preference. You know how sometimes I hear people say that you offended me? The word offense actually means cause someone to stumble and sin. And most of the time I've learned in my interaction with people, when they say that, you know, he offended me, I ask them, I say, did he cause you to sin? They say, no. I say, well, offense from the Bible standpoint means that someone literally has caused you to sin. But sometimes it's our personal preferences. We didn't like the way they looked at us. We didn't like the way they talked to us. We didn't like the way they shake our hand or didn't shake our hand. We didn't like what they put on Facebook. We didn't like the text. I kind of feel like they were saying something in that text. I have no idea what that means, but it felt like something. It did me something. When I read the, y'all get what I'm saying, right? So sometimes those things that we call hurtful are not really hurtful based upon the scriptures. It is our personal preferences. And I'm only talking to mature folk when I say this. Get over yourself. I'm just talking to mature folk now. Again, if you're not there, I promise I didn't mean to hurt your feelings, but I'm talking about those of you who are mature. Get over yourself. Because when you think about it, all the things we do against God in comparison to what folk do against us, I'm saying we need to get over ourselves. Amen. If you can't say amen, say ouch. But say something. Y'all looking at me like yeah, get over yourself. Don't let a personal preference control you. Because here is the issue, what he says in verse 14. For if you forgive men that trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. So the other thing that he is showing us, again, is that in that process, that when we are doing that in verse 14, he says, God our Father has made forgiveness possible. However, putting it to practice is for us. Look at verse 14. God our Father has made forgiveness possible. Putting it to practice is on us. Did y'all hear what I said? Everything I need to forgive is already in me. So what I can't ever say to God, Father, I'm not there yet. Lord, I need a little more prayer. I need a few more Bible studies. I need a little bit more Holy Spirit. I need a little bit more Jesus. No, he said, you got out of that already. Because he has made it possible for us to forgive. He has made it possible. Again, notice what verse. For if, notice, that's called a subjunctive. Meaning that it is possible, but it's not always probable. I can, but I got to choose to do so. Have you ever noticed that if you upset with somebody, how much they control you? when you don't release them, when you don't pardon them. You ever notice that, how much that person control you? You just think about them. You see them. Oh! They just go sit down. Didn't say nothing to you. Oh, just get on my nerves. That's control. That's just way too much control. I mean, even to the point that thing can make you sick. You see that person's head start hurting. Oh, I got a headache. I need a pill. Really? Because of that person? Because I've got this stuff in me that I just can't let go. So I'm walking around with it, man. And watch this. There are a lot of believers who actually think you got the right to do it. Huh. You just don't know how that joker hurt me. Huh. I'ma show them. But watch this. God is saying, if you don't forgive them, it's right there in the text. If you forgive men that trespasses, if, somebody say if.
If.
You know what if mean? It means it's possible. The question is it, do you make it probable? That it's not just a possibility, it may be, it is the fact that I can, but whether or not I choose, it's a choice. God is saying to me, I can experience the freedom of his forgiveness if I'm willing, watch this, if I'm willing to forgive others.
Yeah.
Then he says in verse 14, verse 15, but if you do not forgive men that trespasses, if the choice is that I'm not going to do it,
yeah.
I'm not going to do it. I don't care what nobody say, I'm not going to do it. They hurt me too much. They hurt me too bad. I mean, it just cut into the core of my being. Folks, you got to understand, God gives you power to overcome everything. God gives you power to be able, because remember what the Bible says to us, that if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things become new. He is reminding you and I that there's nothing we cannot overcome if we trust his power. So here's what he shows us. Other people forfeits our need for forgiveness from our Father.
Yeah.
I'm gonna say it again. Our failure to forgive other people forfeits, it cancels out our need for forgiveness from our Father. One more time. Our failure to forgive other people cancels out, forfeits our need for forgiveness from our Father. We said we need forgiveness daily. But if I'm holding a grudge against somebody, here's what God says. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses. So God is saying to me, Lee, if you want to walk around with a grudge, you want to walk around with a grudge against Pat Smith, you don't want to shake her hand. You don't want to talk to her. You don't want to hear her name. Oh, don't even bring up that name. Are y'all getting what I'm saying? What God is saying to that extent, Lee, why you gonna bring up your name before me? Why you gonna ask me to forgive you for your lies and whatever you cheat, whatever it is that you did? Why are you asking me to forgive you? Why do you want to bring up your name before me when you don't even want to hear? Listen, folks, I'm not doubting that people can do some stuff that will cut you to the core. I'm not doubting that at all, and I'm not diminishing the importance of how people can hurt people. But what we've got to understand, that people don't just hurt us, we also hurt people. And if we don't hurt people, we hurt God, because again, Ephesians say that we can grieve him. One final thing I want to share with you. because here it is. I can't say I've forgiven, but I don't want to have nothing to do with them. Because a lot of times we say that, you know, I forgive them, but I ain't got nothing to do with them. Now watch this, watch this, watch this. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. If we forgive men their trespasses, our Heavenly Father will also what forgive us. Now watch this. Do you want God to say, Lord, I want you to forgive me, but don't have nothing to do with it? Because notice the clause. As we, to the same extent, in the same way that we forgive others, we're asking God to forgive us. And I know some of us, man, that's just a hurtful thing to think. Man, somebody hurt me that bad, and I got to forgive them. I tell you, I'm so glad y'all asked. So here's what I need you to do. Here's what I need you to do. Zach, I need you to help me, man. Go on just a little bit further in the slide. There you go. Keep going for me. Keep going. This is where I want you to go right there. Go back to where you were. Let's turn to Genesis chapter 50 right quick. Genesis chapter 50. I got 20 minutes to do this, and I know I'm not going to finish, but that's all right. Let me show you something. And this is in the word of God. This is in the word of God. Joseph's brothers hated him and wanted him dead. How many of y'all remember that? Remember that story? Joseph's brothers hated him so much that they wanted him dead and they tried to kill him. They threw that boy in a pit. Older brother had to come rescue him. And then they took his coat of many colors, dipped it in blood, and lied and told their daddy that boy was dead. And watch this. For 22 years, Joseph had to deal with the reality that his own family, his own brothers, had tried to kill him. Notice what David's response was. Joseph, thank you. Chapter 15. We love this verse. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, perhaps Joseph will hate us and may actually repay us for all the evil, notice the language, which we did to him. So they sent messengers to Joseph saying, before your father died, he commanded, saying, lying. They just lying. They're lying. Thus you shall say to Joseph, I beg you, please, forgive the trespass of your brothers and their sin. For they, notice the language, did what? Evil. That's somebody who's intentionally trying to hurt. They did evil to you. Now please forgive the trespass of your servants, the God of your father. And Joseph wept when they spoke to him. And when his brothers also went and fell down before his face, they said, behold, we are your servants. Joseph said to them, do not be afraid, for am I in the place of God? Listen to that language. But as for you, you meant it for evil against me, but God meant it for good. Why? In order to bring it about as it is this day, to save many people alive. Now notice verse 21. Now therefore, do not be afraid. I will provide for you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. Next slide, Zach, if you will. Here's how we know we've forgiven, when we willfully provide. If somebody has hurt you, and I'm talking about they hurt you to the core. I mean, it has been very, very painful. But you say you've forgiven. One way that you know you've forgiven is if you willfully provide. If they have a need, you apply the word of God that regardless of the circumstance, you provide the need. And how do you know that? Romans chapter 12 tells us what? If your enemy is hungry, what? Feed him. If he's thirsty, give him drink. If he is naked, clothe him. Here's a second one. How do we know when we have forgiven? Turn to Job 42. Turn to Job 42. Sort of walk with me through here. Job chapter 42. Job 42. This is the end of Job's life. And here's the reason. Job's friends slandered his reputation. They slandered Job. Job kept saying, I didn't do none of those things y'all said. They said, yeah, Job, you did. Oh yeah, you did it. That's why the Lord is treating you the way that he's treating you, because you did it. You disobeyed God. You did things that displeased God. And so therefore, that's why you're in the trouble that you're in. Have we ever said that? Has ever been said to you? Notice what he reminds us in chapter 42, verse 7. And so it was that after the Lord had spoken these words to Job, that the Lord said to Eliphaz, to Temanite, my wrath is aroused against you and your two friends, for you have not spoken of me what is right as my servant Job has. Now therefore take for yourselves 7 bulls, 7 rams, go to my servant Job and offer up for yourselves a burnt offering, and my servant Job, underline it if you don't have it, shall pray for you. For I will accept him, lest I deal with you according to your folly, because you have not spoken of me what was right as my servant Job has. So Eliphaz the Temanite and Bildad the Shuhite and Zophar the Naamathite went and did as the Lord commanded, for the Lord had accepted Job. Next slide. Here's what it shows us. We gotta fervently pray. Now watch this. Not on them, but for them. Because what you gotta understand, God is not our Rottweiler. We can't say to God, sick them, get them. You know how they hurt me, Lord, get them. No, that's not what we're to do. God says we got to fervently pray for them. These three friends had slandered Job to the very core of his being, because Job kept saying to them, I didn't do it, guys. I didn't do it. I didn't do it. I didn't do it. And they kept saying, yes, you did. Yes, you did. Yes, you did. And when God had to deal with them, God said to those friends that had slandered Job, you better go to Job, because he need to pray for you. So we know when we're forgiven, when we can pray for that person that caused us a lot of pain. Here's a third one. Go to 2 Samuel chapter 1. 2 Samuel chapter 1. Thank y'all for turning in your Bibles. I do appreciate it. 2 Samuel chapter 1. Most of us know the story of David and Saul, right? David repeatedly experienced attempted murder by Saul. Saul tried to kill David several times. They sit in that dinner, he tries to throw a spear at him. Several times he tried to kill him. I mean, he got so angry. They did that rap song, you know, Saul has killed his thousands and David has killed his 10,000. And man, Saul is angry now. The Bible says he has a distressed spirit in him that every time he gets a chance, he tries to kill David. But notice something unique here, very, very unique, that even though he knew Saul tried to kill him, notice what happens in verse 11. Therefore, David took hold of his... Now, watch this. It's hard to do it that way. Let's start at verse 1. I want y'all to really see this. Now, it came to pass that at the death of Saul, when David had returned from the slaughter of the Amalekites, and David stayed 2 days in Ziklag, on the third day, behold, it happened that a man came from Saul's camp with his clothes torn, dust on his head. So it was, when he came to David, that he fell to the ground and prostrated himself. And David said to him, where have you come from? So he said, I have escaped from the camp of Israel. Then David said to him, how did the matter go? Please tell me. And he answered, the people have fled from the battle. Many of the people have fallen and dead. And Saul and Jonathan, his son, are dead also. Notice the immediate response. So David said to the young man who told him, how do you know that Saul and Jonathan, his son, are dead? The young man who told him said, as I happened by chance to be on Mount Gilboa, there was Saul leaning on his spear. And indeed, the chariots and horsemen followed hard after him. Now, when he looked behind him, he saw me and called to me and answered, here I am. And he said to me, who are you? So I answered, I am an Amalekite. Yeah. And he said to me again, please stand over me and kill me. Yeah. He was not telling the truth. For anguish has come upon me, but my life still remains in me. So I stood over him and killed him. He's bragging about it. Because I was sure that he could not live after he had fallen. And I took the crown that was on his head and the bracelet that was on his arm and have brought them here to my Lord. Yeah. Therefore, notice what David does in verse 11. Took hold of his own clothes, tore them, and so did all the men who were with him. Notice the emotion that's there. And they mourned and wept and fasted until evening for Saul and for Jonathan his son, for the people of the Lord and for the house of Israel, because they had fallen by the sword. Yeah, yeah, yeah. David didn't do what we would say in Creole, got. They got it. I mean, rejoicing. Oh, I'm so glad he did. He hurt me. He's dead. No, David wept over the fact that the man that tried to kill him was dead. This word of God is something else, y'all. But it's there as an example to you and I to help us understand that God has given us the ability to do what Job did, to do what Joseph did, to do what David did, because the same spirit that was in them is the same spirit that's in us. He goes on with all the way to verse 24, and he says, O daughters of Israel, weep over Saul, who clothed you in scarlet with luxury, who put ornaments of gold on your apparel. This is a song that they made. He said that everybody weep. Even though I know he tried to kill me, he slandered me, he made me, tried to make me look bad before everybody else. He said, it really doesn't matter. Because when I think about what God has done for me, when David is saying, when I think about the fact that I was in a sheepfold, when I was a shepherd boy, but the Lord raised me now to be the king over Israel. Can't worry about what anybody tried to do to me, because the evidence was they couldn't hurt me because I'm still standing. Can I get a witness in here? The evidence was they couldn't take me down because I'm still standing. And who is it got me standing? It's the Lord. I'm still standing. Here's one final one and I'm done. Here's one final one. Let me show you what you got to do. How we know we're forgiven. We purposely choose not to bring up that past. You notice in all that David said, he didn't say, well, you know, maybe that's what should have happened to Saul. He tried to kill me all them times, and so I guess the Lord just got him. But we purposely choose not to bring up their past. I mean, just think about it. Every time we prayed to God, God would start reminding us. Now, you remember, Lee? You remember where you were in 1979 in September? You know, start giving me dates and time. Should have been home. We don't want the Lord to do that to us. So why is it, and understand, if I'm still bringing up the past, it's an indication that I'm not yet still controlling me. Here's the second thing. We pity that suffering and death. Doesn't matter how hurt you've been. If you hear somebody die, that ought to do something to you. If you don't have any compassion, no pity, you hear that a person who may have hurt you is suffering, and you don't pray for them, you don't choose to provide for them, and then you want to bring up that past, and it does not hurt you to know that that person is going through what they're going through. That's how we know we're forgiven. We purposely choose not to bring up that past, and then we pity their suffering and death. And finally, let's go to Acts chapter 6. And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and signs among the people. Then there was some from what is called the synagogue of the freedmen, the Cyrenians, the Alexandrians, and those of Cilicia and Asia, disputing with Stephen. And they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spoke. Then they secretly induced men to say, We have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and God. And they stirred up the people, the elders of scribes, and they came upon him and seized him and brought him to the council. And they also set false witnesses up, and he said, this man does not, they lying, y'all, to cease to speak blasphemous words against the holy place and the law. For we have heard him say that Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and change the customs which Moses delivered to us. And all who sat in the council looking steadfastly at him saw his face as the face of an angel. So what does Saul, what does David do? Starting at verse 1, all the way throughout chapter 7, he is literally given the history of Israel up until the point of Jesus Christ. Now notice what happens at the end of his discourse. And notice that I'm gonna come up to verse 57. Then they cried with a loud voice, chapter 7, verse 57, stopped their ears and ran at him with one accord. And they cast him out of the city and stoned him. And he witnessed, and the witnesses laid down their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul. And they stoned Stephen. Listen, it wasn't no peat gravel. Y'all know what peat gravel is? That's that little tiny gravel, little bitty. You know how we, you know, when we were kids, we, no. These were heavy stones that a man the size of Richard Davis's hand could put in his hand and throw at that man with the intent to kill him. They were actually stoning him. Are y'all getting what I'm saying? It, watch this. It wasn't, they lied on him, but in this case, they are literally, figuratively, I mean, emotionally, they are so angry at him that they're, you ever been that mad that you throw something at somebody? Some of y'all saying, yeah. Yes. Some of y'all saying, no, I ain't gonna tell that. You ever felt, you ever been so angry you wanted to throw something? Well, all of us been there. Yeah. They are literally so angry, they are throwing stones at him. My God. Yeah. And as he was calling on the Lord and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Now look at verse 60, y'all. Now if that don't get you to change your mind about folk hurting you, if this verse don't do it for you, if this episode doesn't do it for you, this man is being stoned. And he knows he's going to die. And notice what he says. Watch this. Then he knelt down, cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. Come on, people. I know we've been hurt. I know folk have done some things against us. And at the same time, some of the stuff that folk have done have been so minuscule. So small, so really insignificant in the grand scheme of things, and we fall out with them. Yeah. We fall out with the church. I ain't going no more. We fall out with our brothers and sisters. I don't want to talk to her no more. I go to church today. If I see him, I'm not going to shake his hand. This man is being stoned to death. Watch this. His name is Stephen. He got hands just like us. Eyes just like us. He bleeds just like us. He's standing saying, Lord, receive my spirit. But do not charge this sin to them. And called it, sin. He knew what they were doing. It was evil and it was intentional. They wanted him dead. But before he died, and I know what some of y'all are real smart right now, saying, well, when I get to that point that I'm going to die, then I might. Well, you don't know when that hour going to come. You don't know when that minute is going to come. Listen, I'm not implying you're going to lose your salvation. No, what I am saying, this is a command that God has given us, and he's given us the ability to do it, and we can do it well. All we got to do is what? Is trust him. He was Stephen. His name wasn't Jesus. And y'all know what? Y'all sure know what happened to him that Friday. Come on, y'all. Come on, y'all. Y'all remember, we getting ready in a few more weeks to celebrate that. And we rejoice every time we hear that. That here is Jesus who been marched up the Via Dolorosa. Here is Jesus who has a crown of thorns pushed down on his head. Here is Jesus who is being beaten and bruised, I mean, to the point that he's literally losing his strength, to the point that somebody else got to help to bear his cross. But he's on the cross. He's on the cross. Now, they've nailed him in his hands. They nailed him in his hands. They nailed him in his feet. They lifted him high. And while those professional persecutors, those professional annihilators, those professional who know torturers, who know how to cause somebody pain, while Jesus is hanging on the cross, he says, Father, a Savior that we admire so much, who was actually hanging on a cross, having never done anything wrong. And you know what I do know today? There's no Jesus Jr. in this building. There's none of us can claim we never did anything wrong. But he's hanging between two thieves, just like he was a common criminal. And he declares, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I need to close by telling you, you can. I know there's one person in here right now saying, Reverend Lee, I hear what you're saying, Pastor. I got it. I know what the words say, but I'm just telling you, you can. I know what you're saying, man. You don't know what I've been through, but I'm just telling you, you can. Rev, you don't know how deep the hurt has been. I'm just telling you, you can. And when you do, you will experience a freedom like nothing you've ever experienced before. You will feel like a load that's been on your shoulder bearing you down is going to be lifted, to the point that the only thing that you'll be able to do at the end of the day is give God the glory and give God the praise. Matter of fact, is there anybody in here today who would, don't mind letting somebody else know, Reverend, I've been there, but right now I am free. Anybody? Come on. If you know it's been your own experience, if you know you've had some hurt and pain, but you have said, Father, I forgive them and I count on your forgiveness, won't you celebrate God right now? Because you know what it feels like to be that free. You know what it's like. And I'm saying to anybody in here, if you haven't experienced it yet, today is a good day to do that. God is allowing some reminder out there that's in the air. I don't know what it's doing. But he's reminding us that life is fleeting, that life can be short, that one day you can be healthy and the next day you can be at the point of death. And to hold grudges and be angry when at any moment you could die or that other person could die. Brothers and sisters, give God the glory. Set yourself free. Help us. Help us. Help us, first of all, to look at ourselves and to know on a daily basis we need your forgiveness. And then, Lord, help us to dismiss, to release, to pardon others the same way that you have released, dismissed, and pardoned us. It's not a thing that we want to do. It's not something that we cherish doing, but God, it's what you said for us to do. You commanded us in your word. You told us to do it. Reminded us in Ephesians chapter 4, be kind-hearted, be tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God in Christ has forgiven us. God, we are so grateful that we've been forgiven. We are so grateful when we take our own personal inventory and recognize within our own selves, if we're adults, we don't deserve to be here. The things that we've done, that we should be dead by now. But Lord, you forgive us. You give us another and another and another and another and another and another and another chance. And so we thank you. So I pray for me, I pray for this congregation, I pray for us. Right in our own congregation, there's some pettiness going on, Lord. Right in our congregation, there are people who holding things against each other in our own congregation. Lord, help us. Help us. Help us. Not to look at the other person, but to look at ourselves. To recognize that if we're going to live a life fulfilling, if we're going to live a life pleasing you, help us to learn to forgive. Just as you have forgiven us. We'll be careful, Lord.